The question hasn't been agreed by majority, respectively, of each of the two groups of members who are present. I declare the motion negatived. Motions, debate on motions with no legislative effect. Motion on revitalizing the mandatory provident fund. Members who wish to speak, please press the request to speak button. I call upon Dr. Honorable Junius HO to speak and move the motion.
President, I'm moving this motion on revitalizing the Mandatory Provident Fund, MPF. And this is because that after the MPF was established, it has attracted a lot of criticisms. The fundamental concept of the MPF is to enable working persons to make personal savings through contributions from both employees and employers and receive returns so as to assist them to cope with life after retirement. Now, the total MPF assets have exceeded over $800 billion, but then the workers have to wait for 65 before they can make use of the MPF's amount. Now, if the savings cannot is not enough, then that goes against the objective of the MPF. Now, from the facts, we see that we are suffering a loss of over $8,000. And according to market reports, now, after inflation, there has only been a net rise of 4% of the amount. I think it's whether it's $8,000 in loss or a rise of 4% in the amount. Well, the overall outcome is not desirable. In recent years, many people are nearing retirement, and they have already retired. Well, they are the newly retired people, I would call them, and they are facing escalating medical costs, and they said that they are very worried, especially well, they are facing huge medical expenses, and they are concerned whether they can pay. Now, let's imagine this. Given the present living standard, well, what is the biggest enemy is aging. And the older you get, the lesser the ability of you to earn, to make money. And do we have enough savings to lead a good retirement life? This is a big question. Now, let's imagine this. What we are we most concerned about, apart from protection, is also our health. Quality of life is directly related to our health. Say, for example, if a person starts to work at 25, he makes 30,000 per month, and if he retires in 65, he works 40 years, and if there is no increase in the monthly salary, and there is no problem of inflation, and so on, well, every year, the MPF amount is $36,000, and in 40 years, it means $1.44 million. Well, on the surface, it sounds quite a good amount, which can provide for a good retirement life. But let's not forget that we have the cost of living rising, inflation will enrolled into this amount. And will this amount be enough for us? Can we maintain our standard of living based on that amount? Well, on the second day of the Lunar New Year, Hon LUK drew a fortune stick. It said that it's good that we have a farmland, we have biscuits, but the farmland cannot be farmed and the biscuit cannot be eaten by us. So that it seems, well, it's a very good analogy. It seems that we have this amount, but can this amount be enough in the future? That is the big question mark.
Well, we must save for a rainy day. We very much hope that we can use savings accumulated now to be prepared for future crisis. Now, if we are healthy at 65, all the best. But if, unfortunately, we have a serious disease involving huge medical expenses, well, I used an example. You started saving at 25, and at 65, assuming no loss, no gain in your MPF benefits, you get $1.44 million, and it can be exhausted by means of a few expensive treatment courses. So you can actually see all your MPF benefits depleted if you have incurred a serious disease. So we should use the MPF benefits well in order to plan for a better future. Now, if we allow our MPF balance to be spent on funds, you can go for high risk, low risk, or guarantee rate of return. But can we set aside part of the contributions for taking out medical insurance? I take myself as example. By paying a premium of $29,000, I can have various benefits. There might be limits on medication and on other expenses, but then there is also a $30 million hospital benefit. So by spending $29,000 in premium, I can in return get a hospital benefit coverage of $30 million. I'm sure this is very attractive to our young old. As soon as you reach a middle age, your health may start to decline, and if we allow them to spend some of their MPF benefits on taking out a hospital plan, it is quite desirable. So that you can invest for your health. You can, I'm sure this is in line with the objective of the MPF scheme, which is to secure quality life after retirement. So I hope members can support my motion. Our money should not just be deposited in the bank, or when it's called for use, you don't have enough. We should be prepared for our future. We should work for our future health. And I think there are a few benefits. First, there is flexibility, and there is more choice. And secondly, you can provide for your future in a timely manner. You don't have to wait until you are 65 years old. Now, let's say there is someone who is already 50 years old, and he will, if he wants to draw down his MPF benefits, he will have to go through a lot of procedures in order he can do so, and then the benefits may not be sufficient to cater for his medical expenses. So I think we can get more protection by spending part of the MPF benefits to take our medical insurance. With insurance coverage, there is no need for him to rely on our public health care system. He can choose to seek medical treatment in a private health care institution, and he is able to do so with support from his insurance benefits. And then resources at our public health care sector can then be reserved for someone in greater need. I think it is a timely proposal on how to use our MPF benefits, because there are criticisms that the management fees are too high, and then the MPF fund members cannot have any say in how the money should be invested. And the administration has made some adjustment to the MPF system, and the administrative and management fees have been revised downwards. Still, they are on the high side. Fund members can choose whether they would like to place their benefits in high risk or low risk or guaranteed return products. The MPF system can be changed from time to time. Address the views and aspirations of the public. Not long ago, I've communicated with my electors. They are mainly from the middle class, and they agree that the MPF benefits can be used for taking our medical insurance as an additional choice. And then I put this question to the CE at question time. Members, can you please turn your mobile phones to the silent mode, because you're disturbing the proceedings. Please continue, Dr. Ho. Well, the CE in return said that because it's called a mandatory provident fund, it must be mandatory in nature, and the benefits are not that much. And then if part of the benefits is spent on medical insurance, then the protection for the future will be lower. I had the opportunity to elaborate my suggestion to the CE on another occasion. Now, if the benefits are used to spend on medical protection for our own self, this is in line with the original intention of the MPF. Well, the MPF benefits in this way can also take care of your current needs as well as future needs. And using the example I just quoted, in fact, we're not talking about a huge amount. We just spend part of the benefits, and we can get huge protection in the future. So this is a win-win situation. So I hope that members of this council can support by my motion on revitalizing the MPF. I understand that there are amendments from members, and I will comment on their amendments after they have spoken. Thank you. And I'll put a question to you that a motion moved by Dr. Junius HO be passed. 6 members will move amendments to this motion. This council will conduct a joint debate on the motion and the amendments.
I will now call upon members who will move their amendments to seek in the following order: Mr. Chan Kin-por, Mr. LUK Chung-hung, Mr. WONG Ting-kwong, Dr. KWOK Ka-ki, Dr. Fernando CHEUNG, and Mr. Porcher, but they may not move the amendments at this stage. Mr. Chan Kin-por, President, there are many negative comments made on the MPF. It's always often said that the return is low, and I just want to say something about the rate of return. The return of MPF, it's been rumored that the rate of return is very poor. Such inaccurate information has caused a lot of public criticism. Many people have placed the exchange fund for a high return, but if you choose carefully, the return of your MPF account can be even better. Well, I've been in the past year promoting the reduction of management fees. They have been reduced drastically, but more can be done. And I have changed the figures mentioned in Mr. Dr. Junius Ho's original motion from the 2000 to 2017, the annualized rate of return after deducting administrative fees was 4.8%. So on average, you gain 4.8%. And the inflation during that period is just 1.8%. But for the latest figure for 2018, you know that the stock market dropped a lot in 2018. But from January to this moment, it has been the stock market has rebounded. So I would like to quote the annual figure for 2018. 80% of MPF investments are in equities or the mixed assets investment. Let's look at the return. As I would like to repeat, from 2000 to 2018, then after deducting the administrative fees for the equities investment is 5% annually. So for 18 years, 5% annually. Index fund, 5.5%, which is even higher. Well, nowadays it's difficult to find a higher return like this. Mixed asset, 4.3%. During the same time, the exchange fund only recorded a 4.3% return. The bonds, 2.5%, the guarantee funds, 1.1%, conservative investments, 0.7%. The figures tell the full picture. The MPF return has been quite good unless you choose the guarantee funds or conservative funds, because the return was only 1.1% or 0.7%. That is lower than inflation rate. Exchange rate is 4.3%. And MPF 4.1%, but this the return for MPF is after deducting administrative fees, while that for the exchange fund has not been after deducting the administrative fees. Well, MPF return has to be accumulated over time because of the volatile the investment market. For example, last year, the return was a negative 8.83% after a drop of 4,000 points of the stock index, but it's now 22.3% in the first few months of this month. We have seen a rebound, thus we have to take a long-term view. We should not look at a particular year and say that the MPF rate of return is bad. And of course, we cannot say that because of rate of return in 2017 was good, MPF rate of return was good. There are ups and downs, but after two financial crises in that period, we still have a 5% average return. That's quite good. The low return rate of return will only happen to the guarantee funds and the conservative funds. Contributors are smart. They only account for 20%. And we want to take a long-term view so that the people can take a long-term view and will not be affected by the volatilities when they were about to retire. And also, it would allow the smart investors to put their money in a guaranteed fund and other low-risk funds to avoid the bear market. People don't know what to choose, they can use a Hang Seng index-linked investment, which would attract a very low administrative fee. And I also want to promote financial management education to teach people how to effectively manage MPF so that they will not be misled by wrong information and misleading advice. And as a result, they have chosen the wrong funds. And I hope that the people in the market should not spread untrue information. Well, I've been asking the government to take effective measures to reduce administrative fees. We are seeing a decline from 2.1% in 2005
2007 to 1.5% recently. There's still room for downward adjustment. But to be fair, there's a historical reason why we started with higher administrative fees, because there was the need to implement the statutory system. They had need to deploy manpower to handle contributions. They need to invest in computer systems, and that meant a lot of investment. At that time, the total pool of MPF contribution was low. So as a result, the administrative fees was proportionally higher. With increasing the contributions and the streamlining of the procedure, we can reduce the administrative fees. That's why I want to promote a paperless system and e-platform for MPF so that we can further reduce administrative funds. If 90% of the contribution are handled paperlessly, we can save $35 billion. If you choose an index funds, the administrative fee is just 0.7%, and the return is quite good. And some people are saying that we are not allowing a decent retirement life. It's because of a low contribution rate. Singapore is 3.7%, and we is 3.7 times of what we do. And because of the low contribution rate, we are not able to offer much for people's retirement life. I hope the government can encourage a more voluntary contribution. There's at present $10 billion of voluntary contribution in the MPF system. So it shows that the system is attractive to them. Otherwise, such a voluntary contributions would be gone very quickly. And Mr. Paul Chair has asked for people to put money into passive index funds, but you have to mindful that the banks also charge high fees. It's a 1.6% in terms of a cost. And also the MPF is a 0.71%. That means that if you do this on your own by purchasing index funds, you pay double the administrative fees. Of course, there are problems with MPF system, but there are many unfair and misleading information circulating in the community, leading to a very bad impression on the part of people. And now the good news is not disseminated, but bad news is very influential. Understand that the original motion and the amendments would all be about criticizing the motion. Otherwise, the motion or the amendments will not be passed. It's not important whether my amendment is pass. I just want the public to know the accurate information about the rate of return. That would be the purpose.
Mr. LUK CHUNG-HUNG, President.
Dr. Junius HO's motion on revitalizing the MPF is an issue very close to the hearts of many employees. However, the FTU's understanding of revitalizing the MPF is different from that of Dr. Ho, so we've no choice but to vote down his motion. The emphasis of Dr. Ho's motion is to revitalize the MPF so that our scheme members can take out medical insurance so that when they are sick, they don't have to patronize our public health care sector to alleviate the burden on our public health care sector. This may be well-intentioned, but it has departed from the intention of MPF, which is not a medical insurance. Rather, it is a regular saving scheme for employees so that we can save for our retirement life. The contributions to our MPF is very low. It's not like Singapore, where the contribution rate is 37%. In Hong Kong, it's just 10%. So
whether it should be for taking out medical insurance or for the down payment of a flat as proposed by Mr. Porter. This will greatly undermine the effectiveness of the MPF system. We're always against using MPF benefits or for offsetting long service payment and severance pay for the same reasons. Now, our MPF have very high administrative fees and fund management fees with very low return. What business can you find in Hong Kong where there is guaranteed profits? I think trustees as MPF funds, I think they have earned more than $100 billion in management fees. No matter how bad the returns are, how poor the performance the funds are, you still get the same amount of management fees. So how can employees feel satisfied? So our motion, our amendment seeks to improve and plug the loopholes in the MPF system to enhance protection for employees. First, once again, we urge the administration to expeditiously implement the abolition of MPF offsetting mechanism, which is unfair, unreasonable, and unjust. While the administration has confirmed that this is the way forward, we fail to understand why must we wait for another 5 years? Why can it only be implemented in 2024? Can we have a bill within this legislative term? I believe this will have the support of most members in this council, regardless of the political affiliations. There will be sufficient time for the bill to be passed. Secondly, even after the bill is passed, we'll have to wait for 2 more years. According to the administration, the bill should be introduced in the next term of government, and then 2 years afterwards, the bill can be implemented. Why 2 years? I think 1 year is sufficient for preparation, because the offsetting mechanism is eroding at least $3 to $4 billion from the benefits of employees. Every year, the really grassroots employers, employees in the cleansing, security, and catering business, they really rely on MPF benefits for the retirement. Now, if their benefits are eroded by offsetting, then come their retirement, when they don't have enough money, they will rely on Social Security. And the government must take the lead for civil servants and non-civil service contract staff and also the outsourced workers. The government should take the lead to abolish the offsetting mechanism to set an example for good employers. And why should the management and ministry fees be so high, although a member said that there was some reduction, but that is too low. In 2015, the average rate was 1.6%, and now it's 1.52%, a reduction of 0.08% in 4 years. That is a very minimum. And it's also because of the default investment strategy, DIS. This is because the MPF system is not a really open market with real competition. You may find this strange. Isn't Hong Kong a free economy? This is because employees are not free to choose the trustees and also the fund companies. Employers will not think of for employees whether the performance is good, whether the fees are high. They will only go for expediency and convenience, like they may choose a bank, which is their usual banking, their usual operating bank. So for these fund managers, they don't care, because no matter what the performance is, they will get the same amount of management fees. And they don't care about the administrative costs, and they don't want to compete with prices. And we still have not full portability of MPF because of because the offsetting mechanism is not yet abolished, and therefore it should be abolished ASAP so that we can overcome the technical obstacle for MPF full portability. After we have abolished the offsetting mechanism, we will have real MPF full portability, and then the competition in this sector will be increased, and fees can then go down. Now, the fee is capped at 0.95%. It is on the low side. Using AP7FA Sweden as example, the management fee is as low as 0.06 to 0.1%. So in Hong Kong, the fees are far too high. So we must continue to review our system and further lower the cap for management fees. Now, for instance, Hong Kong MA can set up central DIS schemes, and then it can set the landmark yardstick for low management fees. I hope that the review of DIS conducted in 2016 can announce its results ASAP. And the government should promote or regulate fund trustees to launch more low-fee funds, such as index funds. A member said that the returns from index fund could be much higher than funds with a very proactive management, mainly due to savings in management fees. And there are also funds, preservation funds, very close to inflation. Take China Life as example. It's a guarantee fund will guarantee a return of 2.5%. That means that there are market players who are able to achieve that. It is commercially viable. And why can't the government regulate or require all fund trustees to provide such kind of funds? Because the current guarantee fund has is giving a ridiculously low rate of return, and it is not effective in helping employees to combat inflation at all. So there should be more choices. And part five of my amendment, the government should pay employees MPF contributions for low-income scheme, because if you are making less than $7,100 per month, you don't have to contribute to an MPF scheme. Now, there are low-income earners. The government should pay MPF on their behalf so that their balance will not be too low, leaving no protection for them in the future. At the end of the day, the FTU is for a universal retirement protection scheme with tripartite contribution from employers, employees, and the government, so as to provide comprehensive retirement protection for employees. Before achieving that, we have to improve our MPF system in terms of returns and fees and diversity. The government has the responsibility to promote reforms in this regard. It should introduce bold reforms to our MPF system in order to safeguard the retirement protection of employees in Hong Kong.
Mr. WONG Ting-kwong, thank you, Chairman. I declare that I was a non-executive director of the MPF Authority for 6 years, and subsequently, I was the chairman of a consultative committee under the MPFA for 6 years. We have seen many discussions on the MPF regime over the past 10 years, and there are two main areas of concern for the public. First of all, the public has expectations on the use of MPF contributions, and they hope that such use can be relaxed, and that way they can enjoy more retirement investment choices. And the other issue is the high charges, which eat into the contributions. In recent years, the MPFA has launched a series of initiatives to lower the charges for the average charge ratio was lowered from 2.1% in 2007 to 1.52%. And the MPFA announced that through a consultancy study that the average fee would be lowered to 1%, and there's still a difference of nearly 1%, so the MPFA definitely needs to work harder. Since the MPF regime was introduced, compared with the 1980s and 90s, the market fluctuations were much more frequent. In 2017, in the bull market, everyone was making money. If you invest your MPF contributions in the Hong Kong equity market, you would enjoy very high returns. And subsequently, we saw the China-US trade tensions, and there was a reversal in the market trend in 2018. And in terms of the MPF contributions, many people, many scheme members made substantial losses, and many of them decided to go for the conservative or guaranteed funds, which did not achieve high returns, and yet they had to pay high costs or charges, and that led to a negative impression of the MPF regime. And every month, members' income would be eroded, and they are forced to continue to contribute to the MPF account. So all these go against the intents of the MPF regime. However, many members have this impression, and as such, the DAB has been urging the government to refine the MPF regime by promoting MPF portability as well as fixed charges by MPF trustees, and to take up some of the costs associated with the default investment strategy, and including the actual fixed cost capped at 2%, including the audit fees, etc. And these would help lower the costs charged by MPF trustees. Currently, the fees charged by MPF trustees is based on a fixed percentage of the account values. MPF has been implemented for 18 years, and total assets have exceeded 800 billion Hong Kong dollars. As the value continues to grow, economies of scale, as well as a lowering of costs should be achieved. If a percentage-based fee will continue to be imposed, the fees would expand disproportionately. Hong Kong has a number of provident schemes, and for fees charged in places like UK and Australia, fixed fees are being charged. And as such, the DAB should urge the MPFA to study and require MPF trustees to charge fixed administrative costs, and it should be linked to inflation, and the fees should no longer be based on a percentage of the MPF account values. According to the consultancy study, and based on an average fund expense ratio of 1.74%, administrative costs makes up 0.7%, while investment costs makes up 0.59%, and it shows the proportion of administrative costs is extremely high. And with the launch of the eMPF platform, administrative costs should be further lowered, and by switching to a fixed administrative cost, it would be more reasonable, and on the long run, scheme members can accumulate greater value in their accounts. And the MPFA should consider the pros and cons of the fixed cost option. The fixed charges would mean that the newer members would have to pay a relatively higher proportion in administrative costs. And DIS has somewhat solved the problem of excessive fees, and in terms of investment returns, DIS cannot achieve stable returns. Some members expect that their investment returns should be in line with inflation, and as such, the DAB has suggested that the MPF returns should either, the products should either be linked to the exchange fund returns or inflation, and scheme members should be able to choose to vest their accrued benefits with the exchange fund. And as such, an exchange fund linked MPF constituency fund should be introduced, and investment at the exchange fund should be allowed, and the monetary authority should be the MPF trustee to provide reliable MPF schemes. And to lower the management fees, the funds should be invested in the government's I-bond. And apart from DIS, the government should establish products resembling bank deposits that charge no management fee. For members age 55 or above, the government should provide an extra option, and this can help safeguard people who are about to retire when they encounter an economic cycle such as a financial tsunami. Their accrued benefits would not be greatly eroded due to market conditions. As to increasing the flexibility of the MPF accounts, some of the accrued benefits should be allowed for first-time home purchase or taking out medical insurance. The DAB is supportive of the idea, and the government should study that. In terms of housing acquisition, scheme members should be able to apply to the MPFA to partially withdraw their benefits for first-time home purchase. And in order to prevent abuse or speculative activities, and to allow members to enjoy comfortable housing, there should be certain restrictions for people who sell their properties before the age 65. Please stop speaking. Thank you.
各位主席, 首先我就...
Dr. KWOK Ka-ki, first of all, I'd like to thank Dr. Junius HO for moving this motion. Let's apply his logic, which is interesting. In his speech, and of course in the text of the motion, he's basically saying that MPF is no good. Administration fees are too high, the rate of return not satisfactory, and after inflation, the benefits will be eroded seriously. I basically agree. So he's saying that why not use the MPF interest to take out medical insurance? Then you'll be jumping from one hell to another hell. Why? Why did we start with the MPF? It's because the government rejected
the Universal Retirement Protection Scheme. That's a product of a compromise. The government said that we need to provide retirement protection. And the government's idea was to give the task to fund managers, and we might achieve better results. But the history so far has told us the truth. The administration fees are so high that this MPF system has been proved ineffective. Ineffectual, but retirement protection schemes are nothing new. There are many, many such schemes around the world. The average of fees in Hong Kong would be 0.69 for the currency funds, or 3.39% for the other fund, compared with Australia's 0.8% or 0.1% of the Netherlands, as well as other tightly managed retirement funds. We are more than 1,000 times the average, in terms of average cost. The MPF is not here to provide retirement protection to the working class. It's there to benefit trustees, managers, who would get a share. And in other words, major insurance companies and banks stand to benefit from it, notwithstanding the criticism from Ms. Dr. Junius Ho. Then, very quickly, Mr. Chan Kin-por, in his amendment, delete all your criticisms, the factual information in your original motion in the form of an amendment. I think the relevant sectors are interested in getting as much out of it as possible. That's what they want. Why do we not go for a universal retirement protection scheme? Instead, we get this. The last term government asked Professor Nelson Chow to conduct a comprehensive study. And in terms of public support, in 2016, according to a government survey, they received 18,000 submissions. Most people accepted the introduction of means-tested universal retirement protection scheme. This is not a populist idea. Many countries are doing this. If the consultant entrusted by the government, or that is Professor Chow, also carry out some actuarial assessment, it's said that to start such a scheme, you need $100 billion. And because of this tripartite contribution system, it will not involve long-term government commitment or increasing commitment on the part of government, because it's tripartite. So if you take into account the OAA and the CSSA contributions, the burden on the government would be lessened instead. But things are never as simple as that. Mr. Wong Yunfei said yesterday that he was fortunate not to become Professor Nelson Chow 2.0. The ethical standards of the government are so low that the report from the consultants that it engaged could be shelved and ignored. I would say the government has failed the whole working population of 3 million plus in Hong Kong. Because people's retirement cannot be supported by an MPF. The government has been trying to hide this mistake through various means, such as forcing those from within the age group of 60 to 64
asking those in the age group of 60 to 64 to work if they apply for CSSA. Please return to the subject matter. So that's the wrong path we took. Second, do we need to always get an insurance coverage to meet medical costs? The research division carried out a study in July 2018. Please be reminded that you please return to the motion itself. But did you see my amendment? I was talking about taking away the part on healthcare insurance. I just don't know how to communicate with you if the kind of level is so low. And only $5.3 billion are paid out of $9 billion. According to the study carried out by our research division, it's lower than 60%. So if instead of keeping your money in MPF accounts, you use it on medical insurance, you are shifting money from one problematic area to another problematic area. You don't solve any problem. 1.35 million people took out insurance, and now there is 2.4 million or 80% of the working population. 950,000 covered by group insurance, and then 1.78 million who do it individually, and there's an overlapping the number of insured of by the 920,000 people. Can we really help them cope with serious healthcare costs? You know that the rate of erosion is 40%. That is to say, 40% goes to the insurance companies. We all know, everyone knows that this is not going to help us solve the cost of the problem of healthcare costs. Actually, the pay young people get is not increasing if we take into account inflation. So it's not unimaginable that they can continue to cope with the rising healthcare costs. If we look at the big data, the government only contribute 2.8% of GDP to the healthcare system. 2.9% comes from the public. A small part coming out of from people's insurance policies. This is not too bad. People have little confidence in getting proper healthcare protection through insurance. People who are knowledgeable about healthcare services, you know that the insurance coverage is really not adequate. Just look at target therapy. How can you get the protection you need? Of course, the insurance companies know very well that they can get a profit. If you ask us to invest more in insurance policies for healthcare, that means more money will go to big financial institutions. I hope members will support my amendment so that we can get a universal retirement protection scheme as early as possible. Dr. Fernando Cheung. President, the MPF system has been criticized by our people for over 20 years, and we can do nothing about it. And now we have this motion moved by Dr. Junius HO, which points out some of the problems. He wants to revitalize the MPF, but I don't quite agree with the approach suggested. Actually, the MPF represents the wrong direction to take. Before the reunification, the colonial government proposed an old age pension system, which is sort of a universal retirement fund.
At that time, the matter was made political, and at that time, the mainland said that they warned about this system, and as such, a number of countries and academics echoed such view, and they stood against the universal retirement system. And as such, we saw the birth of the MPF system. And at that time, from an academic perspective and a social perspective, I criticized the scheme of being meaningless. And now we have seen how this is proved. The administrative fees under the MPF regime are among the highest in the world. At the beginning, it was 2%, and after years of efforts, the MPFA said many measures have been implemented, and now it is still at more than 1.5%. As some members have pointed out, such fee levels are extremely high. And the government is forcing all members to place their contributions in private companies who would invest for us. And by the time we retire at 65, we can withdraw the benefits. As for the management fees, there is no regulation at all. There are more than 400 constituent funds, and there are so many MPF trustees. The average employee does not know about, or they know nothing about investment, and the employer would choose the trustee. So the entire MPF regime has forced all employees in Hong Kong to contribute some of their wages, and the so-called MPF trustees, including banks, can charge fees that are 5 or 10 times higher than the international norm, and we all fall victim to the system. The MPF regime has been in place for almost 20 years. Well, it has been 17 years. It was introduced in 2000, so it has been nearly 20 years. The total account value amounted to more than $800 billion for administrative alone. The accumulated fees charged was almost $100 billion. So this is a very profitable business. I read a column by Jack Wellington on SCMP. He said that Standard Chartered Bank sold their MPF business to Manulife for $400 million. And this made up about 24% of the total MPF contributions. And the MPF business amounts to 129 or $12.9 billion. This is big business. Every year, more than $100 billion worth of MPF contributions go go into the MPF trustees and they would decide how they invest our money. President, apparently the MPF regime is supposed to provide retirement protection for employees. But are they the only people who need retirement protection? Well, their family also need retirement support. And these include housewives, disabled people, or low-income individuals, or people who work casual jobs. They are not being protected, or their protections are inadequate. So this regime is not helping the people most in need. And secondly, you are forcing us to surrender our hard-earned money and savings. And our wages are already meager in Hong Kong, and our wages are much lower than many other economies. And now we are forced to hand over part of our money to the MPF trustees. This system is extremely irresponsible, and the government is not regulating how much fees are charged by these trustees. And recently, the government introduced some default investment strategy, and that costs were lowered. And going forward, they will introduce an eMPF platform to consolidate all the different MPF schemes. And hopefully, the information portal for members would help lower the administrative fees. It is peculiar that some 60% of the MPF transactions are still conducted with paper, even in this digital age. Are we saying that with all these paperwork and paper transactions, our management fees remain high? So what has the MPFA done in the last 10 years? And what have you done to lower the admin fees? So my amendment is a very humble one. I'm just asking for central management of the contribution collection. You should learn from Singapore. It has been implemented a long time ago in Singapore. So why are we still handing over the people's hard-earned cash to these MPF trustees who are eroding our contributions? Why isn't the government taking the responsibility? So why isn't the government assuming control gradually of the MPF regime? And this the system does not have any risk-sharing mechanism. And on the long run, we should look at retirement insurance or pension. If the government doesn't do anything, the challenges brought about by aging would only become more serious. Thank you.
Mr. Pawsey, retirement protection the future decades is important, but a more pressing issue now is housing. We are living in smaller and smaller flats, and healthcare healthcare, our public healthcare sector is bursting to the seams. So people want to save up so that they can have their own homes and they can raise a family. They can have their own medical coverage so that they don't have to stay in overcrowded public hospital wards. And then the MPF scheme is very defective, many loopholes, the management and administration fees are high, the returns are low, and I think the benefits can be used for down payment of first home purchase and for addressing medical needs. I said many years ago that young people should be allowed to use the MPF benefits for down payment of first home purchase. The motion was passed after amendment because 19 billion dollars of benefits have been accumulated into our MPF system, and back then you only need $470,000 for down payment of a small flat in Lai Chi Court. So when we have there is also a reverse mortgage, and if we revitalize the reverse mortgage system and make it more flexible, there's Mr. Xiong Ching said we can enhance liquidity, and there will be income for the elderly, and there will also even be money left for their children. So I have amended the motion by saying that employees should be allowed to subscribe to funds like the Tracker Fund of Hong Kong. They are rather passive with lower management fees, and employees should be allowed to make that decision on their own. The MPF management and administration fees are eroding our benefits. I think this is a well-admitted fact here, with the exception of Mr. Chan Kin-por. And these trustees can get the management fees regardless of the performance of the funds. And certainly back as in 2014 September, Mr. Lam Boon Nei was saying that the fees would erode $70 billion of benefits. If you don't trust me, Mr. Chan Kin-por, I can give you statistics. As at September 2018, there are now $858 billion accumulated in benefits. And then the trustees have already earned almost 1% of the benefits. So how can people contribute to MPF funds happily? Now, if we look at the investment returns, Mr. Chan Kin-por criticized me. He said that, of course, you have to pay the trustees for their service, but even though they have done something, that doesn't mean that they have achieved anything. Since the establishment of the Tracker Fund, the return has been 7.3% against 4.5% of MPF, as claimed by Mr. Chan Kin-por. According to the Ming Pao, in September 2018, the return was only 4.1%, right? There's a discrepancy of 0.7%. So it is far lower than 7.3% of Tracker Fund. Mr. Chan Kin-por criticized a member on the 23rd of July. I believe he was referring to me. He said that fund managers were doing things, and you should not just look at the performance in 1 year, and we should not just too lightly compared with other countries like Singapore. I accept his criticism, although it is wrong. Whether it be members here or critics out there, I think Mr. Chan Kin-por has insulted all members here with the exception of himself, and all critics out there with the exception of himself. If you look at statistics, now, for the MPF market, close to 70% of the money is invested in the equity market. And he said that in 2017, the return of MPF was 22.3% from the equity market. Yes, that was a very good year. But how about the relevant performance in the Hang Seng Index? The rise was 35%. And then the fund managers could not catch up with the increase in Hang Seng Index, but they have collected the management fees in full.
Now, for the industry, they do not rely on the decision and also the wisdom of fund managers. Rather, most of them would have invested in passive index funds like the tracker fund, and this is very satirical. So even retail investors know how to achieve this kind of return. Why should we pay fund managers that amount of money? Why shouldn't members be allowed to spend the money and invest in low-income passive index funds like the tracker fund of Hong Kong, which charges 0.09% in management fee? And management or trustees of MPF schemes charge on average 15 to 20 times that of the amount charged by the tracker fund. Well, this is these are accurate and real figures. Mr. Chan Kin-por said that if you invest in tracker fund on your own, you have to pay transaction fees on a monthly basis. Well, you don't have to buy it every month. You can do it twice a year. So let's say you store $24,000, you save $24,000 per year, and you multiply by 0.25%, the transaction cost is only 60%. You can, for instance, purchase 1,000 shares, that is two lots, and then it's $39,000. And if you include stamp duty and transaction costs, it's just about $100. I have rarely seen anyone who invests in tracker fund on a monthly basis. Of course, I accept Mr. Chan Kin-por's proposal. In the long term, as legislators, we should be fair and accurate. We should stick to facts and we must be fair. Well, I think he was criticizing me. But another word of advice for Mr. Chang, I was an FC member once for 4 years. I was never criticized for only taking care of the interests of the industry at the expense of the public. I hope Mr. Chan Kin-por can heed my advice, because I have to be accountable to investors and to the community. I must be fair. I must stick to facts. I think what the consequence I face may be more serious than Mr. Chan or those who can be returned without any election. Chinese people know how to save for a rainy day. Less than 10% of the population would take a couldn't care less attitude for their retirement. 90% of them will plan for their retirement, and most of them will take care of their elderly parents. There is no need for us to legislate to mandate our public to take care of the elderly. I just want to ensure that the majority will not suffer as a result of the minority or people like Mr. Chan Kin-por, who only represent his own sector and will not be forced to invest in fund with very low return and high fees. My proposal is just to give an additional choice to our public. There is no need to have so many mandatory items. Now, there are too many mandatory measures in society, and even IQS will be banned. Even smoke no burn cigarette is not going to be phased out. Now, for Obamacare, it was abolished after 4 years when it was proved to be a failure. So I think the government should get rid of this I know best attitude, and you should care for the means of the community. Don't force us to survive in this very difficult situation. Even if you're not going to abolish the MPF system, you should build in more choice for members so that you can be accountable to the community and you won't be just accountable to one FC member.
Secretary for Financial Services and the Treasury.
Sick.
Madam Deputy, first of all, I'd like to thank Dr. Junius HO for moving this motion, as well as the motions as amended by Mr. Chan Kin-por, Mr. Michael Luk, Mr. Wong Ting-kwong, Dr. K. Kwok, Dr. Fernando Cheung, and Mr. Paul Chair. Since its implementation in the year 2000, the government and MPF authority have constantly refined the MPF regime to enhance the effectiveness of the MPF regime in Hong Kong's overall retirement protection system and to improve the retirement protections for the working population. The motion and amendments provide a valuable opportunity for us to exchange views on the function and development of the MPF regime. I would speak on the objective performance and improvement measures of the MPF regime. First of all, the objective. The objective of the MPF regime is to provide basic retirement protection for Hong Kong's working population. As part of Hong Kong's retirement protection system, the MPF regime fulfills the Pier 2 requirement under the multi-peer retirement protection scheme advocated by the World Bank to provide mandatory retirement savings for Hong Kong's working population. The MPF regime complements other retirement protection pillars such as social welfare. As such, members and the public should not equate the MPF regime with Hong Kong's retirement system because the MPF regime is only part of the system. MPF is a long-term savings plan dedicated for retirement purposes, so there are preservation requirements. Save for statutory grounds of withdrawal such as total incapacity or terminal illness, scheme members can only withdraw accrued benefits at the age of 65. If scheme members are allowed to withdraw part of their accrued benefits anytime, the benefits would be constantly lost and the objective of retirement protection cannot be met. If a multi-purpose savings plan is to be set up to provide for housing acquisition or healthcare apart from retirement protection or savings, a reasonable arrangement would be to set up different dedicated accounts, and the retirement account must retain preservation requirements in order to achieve long-term savings. And in order to allow for multi-purpose savings, the contribution rates must be increased for it to be feasible. For the Central Provident Fund scheme in Singapore, contributions would be vested in three different accounts. In other words, the ordinary account for housing investment and education, and two, a special account for retirement savings, and three, a MediSave account for healthcare expenses. The contribution rates to the three different accounts will change based on the member's age. For employees under the age of 35, the total contribution rates of the employers and employees is 37%, of which 23% would be deposited into the housing schemes, 6% to the retirement schemes, and 8% to the medical schemes. And now I'd like to talk about the performance of the MPF. In terms of coverage, compared with the time before MPF was implemented, well, at that time, only one-third of the working population enjoyed retirement protection. And at the moment, with the MPF system and other retirement protection schemes, 85% of the working population are receiving different levels of retirement protection. In terms of the rates of return, according to MPFA figures as of the 30th of September last year, the MPF contributions and investment returns have grown to $858.3 billion, and after deducting fees and charges, the net investment returns since the establishment of the regime is $245.2 billion, and the annualized internal rate of return is 4.1%. I stress that this is the rate of return net of fees and charges. And in the same period, the annualized change in CPA was 1.8%. We also stress that planning for retirement is a long-term savings and investment plan, and it is and not a speculative activity. And as such, we should look at the long-term overall returns rather than the fluctuations in certain asset classes or the short-term investment market. Now, I'd like to talk about the improvement measures on the MPF regime. In the face of population aging, I believe that most people agree that a mandatory savings system is necessary to provide for long-term retirement savings for the working population. The key is whether there's value for money. Around the world, there are many discussions and studies on refining the retirement savings schemes to create more value for money, and these have to do with cost and return. We cannot control investment return, but we can control the associated risks and attempt to lower the costs. In order to keep the MPF regime up to date to benefit the working population, the government and MPFA have been refining the MPF system in different areas, and I'd like to cite some examples. To address concerns from certain members of the public on the high charges and difficulties in making MPF choices, in April 2017, we launched the Default Investment Strategy Scheme with a fee cap. From April 2017 to September 2018, the Core Accumulation Fund and Age 65 Plus funds under different MPF regimes enjoyed annualized returns of 7.3% and 2.4% respectively. Since the DIS legislation was passed in May 2016, and from that time to January this year, the average fund expense ratio of MPF funds was lowered from 1.57% to 1.52%. 136 MPF schemes have lowered their charges, with the lowest, with the biggest drop at 54.55%. We can see that the DIS has piled on pressure for other MPF schemes to lower their charges, and as such, the current fee cap of DIS is 0.75%. On the long run, the relevant levels would be further lowered. We, within three years after the implementation of DIS, we will review the relevant fee cap, and the relevant cap would be further lowered. Meanwhile, there are views that the administrative costs associated with MPF is scattered and complicated, and the paper-based transactions lead to high admin costs. And as such, we are planning to develop a centralized electronic platform for MPF to standardize, streamline, and automate the administrative work to improve operational efficiency and lower the costs. We would create a paperless MPF experience. In December last year, we have briefed the LegCo Financial Affairs Panel on the government's proposal, and we received support from members. With approval from LegCo, our goal is to complete the construction of the system by 2022. Madam Deputy, we would continue to take in views from members on the motion and amendments, and we would offer a holistic response at the end. Thank you.
公營醫療.
Dr. Pierre Chan, the medical and healthcare sector is facing tremendous work pressure. As the representative of that constituency, I would like to say something about Dr. Junius Ho's motion in that he advocates more people taking out medical insurance. This is very attractive to me as the representative of the medical healthcare sector, because the more people who has taken out the medical insurance, the more the burden on the public sector will be lessened. But let's look at the
intention of this MPF system in the first place. In the colonial era, the government already looked into various ideas of a provident fund for the community. There's one on old age pension system, but that would mean a heavy burden on the public coffers. And as a result, the government decided to go for an MPF system in the year 2000, and contribution will be managed by the managers. Well, I'm young enough to count myself as one of the contributors to the MPF system. One of the criticisms of the MPF system is the offsetting mechanism. To cope with the business sector's descent, employers are allowed to use their contribution to the MPF to offset severance payment and also other the payment for redundancy, but now the mechanism is about to be cancelled. We don't know when, but for the 18 years since the introduction of MPF, we have been seeing very poor performance of the return of MPF. And the administration fees are very high. This has happened to me personally. It's been said that only the trustees and managers stand to benefit from this. In the last term of LegCo, the FTU members also move a motion during which a number of amendments to the system were proposed, such as cancelling the offsetting mechanism and also to set a cap on the administrative costs as a ratio to contribution, and also asking the government to act as a public trustee, thereby charging a lower administration cost. And there should be another universal system for those who are not covered by the MPF. But the motion was not passed. I'm more in favor of the review. Please adjust your mic for clearer reception. Okay. I'm in favor of reviewing the MPF system to enhance the retirement protection for working people, instead of changing the uses that can be put to our MPF contributions. It's not easy to save enough for retirement protection. MPF is an important part of that protection. If we don't want to have the benefits eroded by management administration fees, it would take a higher contribution from the employer or from the government. At present, the contribution rate is 5%, capped at $3,000. And if you take out an insurance, medical insurance policies, you can easily take away the entire amount of contribution. And then there may be problems with the coverage. You may have some pre-existing conditions which will not be covered. So using your MPF benefits to take out the medical insurance might end up in having no protection at all. Is that the MPF benefits can be used to buy a home, or medical insurance coverage, because that's happened to Singaporean, but the contribution rate is 24% for those who are under the age of 50, and the employer also contribute 17.5%, and the government also offer a guaranteed rate of return of 2.5% to 4%. But in Hong Kong, we leave all these to the market, with just a few major fund management companies. Singapore is a country. Hong Kong is not. Singapore has got its own
population policy, and Hong Kong doesn't have one, so it's difficult to make comparisons like this. I said this many times in this council. Hong Kong is one of the most wealthy cities in the world. The government sits on a huge reserve. But in terms of protection, we are lagging far behind behind other advanced economies, whether it's retirement or medical and health care and so on and so forth. The government keeps itself away from the market, so big consortia get to the benefit from any protection system. Look at the voluntary medical insurance scheme. At first, we were guaranteed there would be a high risk pool, scheme will not reject anyone. But then, very often, the original objective were forgotten. Last Thursday, the Financial Development Council issued a document on the future of MPF, advocating a tax deduction for voluntary MPF contributions, but it has failed to address any problem related to the benefits of MPF being eroded by high administrative costs. The government should reconsider the issue of introducing a universal scheme for all. Mr. Leung Yu Chung. Madam Deputy, the aging population problem in Hong Kong is getting more and more serious. But the effectiveness of the MPF system has been under constant criticism. What our working people contribute to the schemes, and they are forced to make investments. And what we can see is that on the one hand, they have to pay high administration costs, and a lot of the investment return is taken away. And secondly, these people have to shoulder the risk of investment. Many working people have been complaining about the system, which they think is unfair and unjust. Some of the working people that I know have been contributing to the MPF for some 20 years now. And they have told me that after so long a period of contribution, the most they can get would be a million plus. Many of them can only have a few hundreds of the thousands of dollars in their account. You know that people live longer and longer, well into 80 plus. So how can they cope with the retirement in the future? As we know that when people age, you rely on healthcare services to even greater extent. If you rely on the public healthcare system, it's simply not enough. And then if you want to use private healthcare services, well, they are very costly. And they are saying that after retirement, apart from meeting the needs in retirement, they have to pay for higher healthcare costs. There are many loopholes in the MPF system. So we need to introduce a reform covering a number of areas. First, the government should manage the MPF contributions and provide a guarantee on the return. Or alternatively, the MPF system should be scrapped, and instead we set up a universal retirement protection scheme with tripartite contributions. If we want to carry out a comprehensive reform to the MPF system, we're not talking about tinkering around the edges. People have been criticizing the system administration cost was high, as much as 1.52%, which is really inexcusable when compared with other countries' similar systems. We should make reference to these other systems. The government or non-profit organizations would act as public trustees so that lower administration costs would be possible. As a result, the rate of return would be higher, so we can make reference to the UK system introduced in 2007. In the UK, the government introduce provide a scheme with low administration costs, with a high retirement protection benefits offered. This is managed by a non-profit organization. The non-profit organization was set up through a loan extended by the government. The operations are monitored by the government so that the working people will not see losses in their investment, and the management can be properly managed. And the contributors can choose investment schemes run by, offered by private entities, but the government at the same time will offer a public trustee product so that people can choose whichever products they would like to invest in. And some other members have talked about, we should look at Singapore. They have the Central Poverty Fund established in the 1960s. They have been making improvements to the CPF system, and now it's a very well established and a comprehensive protection scheme. They can use the benefits for the further educations, buying homes or healthcare. And the system is managed by the government. The cost is low, and there's a guaranteed return of 2.5% per annum, and they underwrite the risk. The money, the benefit can be used to as down payment for a home or for a monthly mortgage as well, a monthly mortgage payment as well. And the government take up the responsibility of guaranteeing retirement protection. And they don't. They leave the choice to the contributors. And as a result, the government can be less involved in implementing further improvement measures for the healthcare system. But when presented with such suggestions, the government would usually drag its feet. If the government does not do a good job in comprehensively reform the MPF system, then the alternative will be to abolish the MPF system and introduce a tripartite contribution system, which is a means-tested retirement protection for all. The MPF system's major flaw is that it's linked to employment. So those who are not employed, who are doing household duties, they take care of their homes, they will not get anything. And also for those with low income from employment, they will not get a good protection. And also if the investment result in losses, then the retirement protection is even worse. Whatever the system we introduce, the government should make sure that everyone would get the protection they deserve.
Right.
Mr. Kenneth Leung, Madam Deputy, let me declare I'm a member of the MPF Advisory Committee. Though I'm a member of the Advisory Committee, I have a lot of views on the MPF scheme which was set up in 2002 to serve as a second pillar proposed by the World Bank. People may ask, why should you force people to pay contributions to an MPF scheme? Because MPF is not the only way to save money. Even though you may have a balance of over $1 million in your MPF account, there is no guarantee for comfortable retirement in Hong Kong nowadays. You can also save money in other ways, including investing in tracker fund. It can be another pillar for retirement. So MPF contributions and other forms of savings are not mutually exclusive. Of course, the MPF scheme charges very high administration fees. The MPF as authority as well as industry are trying to improve the system. They have the DIS portability for contributions paid by the employees. And if you have a critical illness, you can also draw down your benefits earlier than 40, 65 years old. Well, even though we have introduced a number of reforms, the system is still far from perfect. But when it comes to abolishing the system, I think it is going to be more complicated than Brexit, because people have saved into MPF schemes for more than a decade, and if you all of a sudden abolish it, it's going to be problematic. I think there is an electronic platform launched by the government that will help to lower the administration cost of MPF. We now have a paperless system, is digitalized, and the government has planned to set up an affiliated company under the MPFS authority to set up an e-platform. But it will take 6 to 5 years before the reform can be realized, and by then, and only by then, that we can calculate the amount of administration fees that can be saved. In addition to a centralized e-platform, we may ask whether 10 years down the road, we can have a central trustee mechanism. Whether it should be the government or a reliable company to be the central trustee can be further discussed. But then, if there is only one single trustee, a lot of cost can be saved. There can still be various funds and fund managers providing different kinds of investment choices to the public with different investment risks. The Financial Services Development Council recently made some recommendations on the MPF system. For instance, should the tax concession for voluntary contribution be greatly enhanced from $60,000 now? Can it be raised to 15% of the employee's income? Well, this 60% tax deduction for voluntary contribution was introduced by the government. Now, if the employee has got other saving schemes, including deferred annuity schemes, it's calculated towards that $60,000 as well. Well, some members of the public are saying that the MPF system charges too much administration fees. And if you propose it to 15%, I think we should wait until to see whether the government's initiative of raising it to $60,000 is working well or not. And the council also asked whether there can be more choice in investment portfolios so that SFC regulated products can become investment tools of MPF benefits. But we have to be careful, because MPF is an important pillar of retirement protection. If we allow investment in high-risk products, then we may be scolded by the public should there be investment losses. So we'll talk about more stable tools such as bonds and funds, and even investment in equity markets will only cover those recognized markets only, and the risks are not extremely high. Can Coming back to Dr. Junius Ho's motion, he asked whether the benefits can be used for taking out medical insurance. Then it may be likely that the annual contributions will be spent on medical insurance, so I have reservation. Mr. Pozzi asked whether the money can be used on paying the down payment of first home purchase. I think it would just be a drop in the ocean. Given the high property prices, how much money is required for the down payment of a first-time home? It's quite likely that the benefits will be depleted as a result, unless we follow the footstep of Singapore and we increase the contribution rate to 25%, but we don't have a consensus over that yet. Thank you. Mr. Tommy Zhang. Thank you, Madam Deputy. I have some comments to make on the motion. I have to repeat once again my dissatisfaction with the system. High administration fees and low returns. Since the suffering of the fund companies have collectively charged over $100 billion in fees. I think the benefits eroded is much higher than the amount lost under the offsetting mechanism, which is only $22 billion. Now, assuming that you start contributing at 22 and you have a medium income of 16,800 and all the way to 65, you have accumulated about $2 million, but 40% of it will be lost in fees, and at the end you only get $1.3 million. The fees are high and there are miscellaneous charges, and I think they are the real culprit in the erosion of MPF benefits. So if members of the public want to enjoy retirement benefits, you should chase after the fund managers instead of employers of SMEs. I've always asked the administration to tackle the problem at source by perfecting the system. Many years ago, a few years ago, the administration introduced the default investment strategy, and also a fee cap was imposed. The government was too slow to act, and this is very disappointing. For the enhancement measures proposed in the amendments asking for trustees' fees to be further lowered to provide more investment choices for investors, of course, I support them in principle. The original motion asked that some of the benefits can be used for taking on medical insurance. I'm worried that only the insurers stand to lose. And how can we ensure that the scheme members can be treated fairly if they really need to use the medical insurance? Now, if the money is spent on a down payment of first home purchase, will this go against the original objective of providing for scheme members' protection? And this may be used as an excuse for abolishing the offsetting mechanism. The government has launched a number of measures to increase the operating cost of enterprises. SMEs are under extreme pressure. I don't want the administration to disregard the difficulties of the business sector and ask them to contribute more. The government has decided to abolish the offsetting mechanism against the wish of the business sector is very undesirable. The business sector feels being betrayed, and this will undermine the credibility of the government. I urge the administration to think twice before implementing that. Thank you.
Mr. Tony Chair. Thank you, Madam Deputy. Madam Deputy, Mr. Chan Kin-por, both, and I myself are both members of G6. We share views on many issues, but on the MPF system, his view and mine are not totally in line. But we have adopted a positive attitude. We try to seek common ground while setting aside certain differences. This motion is moved by Dr. Junius Ho, but I know that Mr. Paul Chair has previously moved another motion saying that we should scrap the MPF system, which is a fraud. Should we scrap the MPF system and introduce the Singaporean-style CPF system or Universal Retirement Protection Scheme? I have not come to any fixed decision. But when I talk to some working people and people in my constituency, I have the impression that they all feel that this is rather unreasonable than unattractive. If MPF managers and trustees achieve a good rate of return at reasonable cost, then of course we would find it acceptable. But there's no correlation between the administration fees and rate of return. The return is usually affected by the overall market situation in the stock market or bonds market. When the markets rise, the rate of return goes up, and the reverse is also true. Has the trustees been doing anything effectively to hedge against the downside impact of the market movements? If they cannot do this, why do we have to pay them to manage our retirement funds? And in the past, we have some capital preservation portfolio or the conservation investment portfolio. I know that capital preservation level is not 100%, and you have to pay a cost, an administration cost. Why don't we allow what proponents of some amendments allowed contributors to ask the exchange fund to manage their investment or to deposit into bank products for fixed income? With regard to Dr. Junius Ho's idea of using MPF to take out medical insurance, and also the idea of Mr. Paul Chair in allowing the contributors to use MPF to buy their own homes, we need to look into the details. Let's look at the idea of home acquisition. MPF system is set up to provide a part of the retirement protection so that when a employee retires at 65, they will get a sum of benefits. In Hong Kong, it seems that property investment can achieve the same objective. The problem is, if you allow an employee to take out all or part of the MPF benefits to buy a home, would you allow them to sell the property and realize the investment before 65? If this is allowed, and the money is spent very quickly afterwards, would it not go against the original objective of providing for their retirement life? If, on the other hand, they cannot sell the property before 65, can it be used for getting a rental income? Can they be allowed to buy a commercial property? Can they trade up for a bigger home? Can they can they take out a second mortgage or increase the mortgage amount in the interim? And if unfortunately the entire amount of MPF benefits are used to buy a home, and then there's the need for the bank to enforce a foreclosure, would the property be allowed to be sold? And of course, any investment can carry some risks of both upward and downward movements.
some people have queried why we don't follow the practice of Singapore, but they have the HOS equivalent in the public housing sector in Singapore. In Hong Kong, you have to pay a premium before you can sell an HOS flat in the open market, but that's not the case in Singapore. And the contribution rate can be as high as 26% of your income. In Hong Kong, the contribution rate of the employer and employee is just 5% each. I have mentioned so many issues, not that well, I want to defend the existing MPF system. In fact, there are many problems requiring the further solutions to be sought. For example, increasing the rate of return, make available more investment choices, so that people will not feel that they are cheated. But whatever we want to do to improve the system, there should be wide consultation before a final decision is made. So I submit, Mr. Houghton Chow. Madam Deputy, first of all, I'd like to thank Dr. Junius HO for moving this motion on revitalizing the MPF. I've heard from members various kinds of opinion on the MPF system. And it's been pointed out that over the years, in terms of the operation of the MPF schemes, the adequacies have been identified. In the eye of the general public, and the impression is that administration fees are really very high. And the performance of the investment may not be very good, but yet the full administration fees are always charged. As a result, many members have said that this is a rip-off in the eye of the public. In 2017, the MPFA introduced a core fund concept. And the management fee level is kept at 1% in response to certain aspirations, providing an additional choice to the contributors, that the risk would be rather low and the cost is not as high. And even before that, I already suggested that if we want to introduce the DIS or core funds, should we ask some other parties to manage the investment apart from the 15 trustees? Should the government do this as well? The government did not accept the suggestion. And at last, the DIS would also be managed by the MPF scheme management companies. So we are talking about the same group of trustees. But at least that would give people one more choice, one more option. At present, there are 15 accredited trustees. In terms of their operation, and also in terms of the setting the administration fees, transparency is lacking. I have raised certain oral questions here. I haven't got a very definitive reply. And if a particular trustee has performed very poorly, is it that the government and the MPFA can really deregister that trustee? If you say we want to promote healthy competition, if there is healthy competition, people are better protected. So in revitalizing the MPF, the government should, in my view, look at the performance of individual trustees. And for those who are not performing, there should be a certain kind of punishment. The government should tell us more about whether this can be done and how it can be done. According to Chairman of MPFA, the total assets accumulated have exceeded $800 billion, a very big sum indeed. Now, Dr. Julius Ho's motion mentions that more users should be allowed for MPF benefits, such as buying the first home, or when you are sick, you can use some of the money for healthcare services. I agree that we can look into both that of these directions. But if we are determined to look into these, there should be suitable restrictions put in place. It's always a question of balance. MPF is supposed to be for retirement. It's one of the pillars for retirement protection. If you want to use the money, the benefits for buying the first home, then you have to make sure that there are certain reasonable restrictions to ensure proper use. As for using the MPF account for meeting healthcare expenses, well, we know that the public healthcare system is not able to cope with the demand. And the government has been encouraging people to make use of public, private healthcare services if they can afford it. So if we allow a greater degree of flexibility in using MPF benefits, this in my view is a direction that merits further consideration. But at the same time, we want the supervision should be there, and there should be suitable arrangements and restrictions on these uses. On the whole, I think this is what the public want to see. The public would like to see the current MPF system more properly managed and supervised.
Mr. Alvin Yang, Madam Deputy, first let me thank Dr. Junius Ho for sponsoring this motion on revitalizing the Mandatory Provident Fund. The motion looks attractive since the introduction of MPF in 2000. Because of the defects in it, it has given rise to a lot of problems associated with employees. In fact, MPF is meant for retirement protection for employees. All those who are over 18 have to contribute to the scheme, and usually you can only draw down the benefits when you reach 65. Unfortunately, it's been close to 20 years since its introduction. Many of the problems have not been resolved. In fact, they have grown into bigger problems. For instance, fees are high and returns are low, and employers have used their contributions to offset severance pay and LSP. For those who are scheme members of MPF, they will agree that it is not an effective tool for retirement protection. Dr. Junius Ho's motion would like to revitalize the MPF. I think it is well intentioned, but we have to consider the logic behind it. Dr. Ho wants the benefits to be used for taking on medical insurance to offer health protection, as well as alleviating the burden on our public healthcare sector. In other words, the government should use a defective MPF retirement protection system to address our defective health care sector. Now, we all agree that our public health care sector is under extreme pressure, but can the problem be resolved by using MPF benefits to take out insurance? Now, our population is aging and medical causes are rising, and there is a shortage of manpower. These are long-standing problems faced our public health care sector, and they cannot be resolved by this solution proposed by Dr. Ho. I think in the long run, we should see whether we should end NHS like the UK, or should we model after Taiwan and or Germany. I think we need further study before coming to a decision. We should not adopt these stopgap approach adopted by proposed by Dr. Ho. We face a heavy burden in our public health care sector. What we need is a major reform instead of tinkering here and there. And to relieve the burden on our public health care sector, we need other policies to help. For instance, we should review the daily quota scheme. We should review the single entry permit scheme. And there is also the allocation of public resources. The government should explain to us the rationale behind the allocation of public resources to ensure that all every Hong Konger is entitled to quality and fair public resource. Now, if we don't know who is coming under the quota scheme, we don't know about their background, then we cannot resolve the problem. We cannot tackle the problem by reforming the MPF. And if we go by Dr. Junius Ho's suggestion to allow members of the public to use the retirement savings to take out medical insurance, I'm just worried that it will be neither here nor there. If people are allowed to draw down their benefits prematurely, then they may not have sufficient retirement savings to maintain a basic quality of life. They will lose retirement protection. And for those who want the benefits to take out medical insurance, we're not sure whether they will continue have money to pay the premium after retirement. That may not be the case, because as you age, the amount of medical expenses you incur will only increase. Now, this benefits is meant for you to spend after retirement, and you allow him to spend it prematurely on something you will need in the future. I think logically we have to reconsider whether this is going to work. And my worry is employees will lose the protection under the MPF system, and they cannot enjoy the benefits of medical insurance. It is all because the government is not willing to reform the system, and because of our population policy leading to lopsided development in the population, then members of the public, if they are required to use their retirement savings to take care of their medical needs, what is the rationale behind that? We all understand that problems arising from the MPF system have to be addressed gradually. However, channeling the MPF benefits into something else will not be able to resolve the problem. It would only give rise to more problems and confusion. I think there's something Carrie Lam's government should face up to. We should fully review our MPF. We should also fully review our public health care system. The two should be done in parallel, but then the two should not be linked. Otherwise, we will not be able to achieve the desired effect. So the message I want to bring out is we must not use the wrong medicine to treat the wrong disease. I'm sure we all know, and I'm sure the government knows where the problem lies. So the Civic Party is going to oppose Dr. Junius Ho's motion. Mr. Ao Nok Kin. Madam Deputy, well, of course, the MPF system